Welcome to the Opportunity Podcast, where entrepreneurs come to learn from real buyers, sellers, and industry experts on the lesser-known growth opportunities to build their online business empires. We'll uncover tactics veteran online business entrepreneurs have used to build, buy, flip, and sell their way towards personal wealth. Sit back, grab a coffee, and get ready to uncover hidden growth secrets. The Opportunity Podcast starts now.
Welcome back to the Opportunity Podcast, your go-to resource for hidden growth opportunities throughout online business. We're your host. I'm Sarah.
And I'm Brandon.
And thanks for joining us for our latest episode.
Yeah, thanks for joining us today. We will be speaking with Alex Champagne, who is the director of sales here at Empire Flippers and has been going on 4 years now. He has seen quite the change over the years from when Empire Flippers first started out to becoming the largest curated marketplace for buying and selling digital assets.
Yeah, so in this episode, Alex is going to go over the rise of private equity and how it's changing everything in the digital acquisition space. He's going to help listeners figure out how to catch the eye of PE early to gain a competitive advantage.
Yeah, really exciting stuff to talk about today, and we won't give away too much now, so let's dig into the interview and see what Alex has to share with everyone. And then at the end of the episode, we'll go over some of the best listings on the Empire Flippers marketplace that highlight the growth opportunities we've learned about here today.
Thanks everyone for joining the show with us today. We have Alex Champagne. He is the director of sales with Empire Flippers, and he's been with the company for 4 years. So thanks for coming on the call with us today, Alex.
Yeah, super glad to be here. Excited to talk.
Yeah, it's really nice having you on this call and really excited to get into the nitty-gritty details of private equity. But let's go ahead and start off with where you got started in online business and a little bit about your background and your start in the online space.
Yeah, sure. So when I was around, I think my freshman year of college, I had the 4-hour work week. And like most people, kind of that's where my story began. I was doing some hustling on like flipping iPhones and jailbreaking them and stuff. And that used to be a thing on Craigslist in high school. So I always had a bit of an entrepreneurial kind of spirit. And I started like messing around with WordPress sites my freshman year. And then by my junior year, I knew that I was just going to kind of focus on that. So I actually dropped out of school and started my own web design and marketing company that specialized in conversion rate optimization. So that's kind of where we developed as a company at that time. And I did that for around 7 or 8 years. And during that time, I was able to work on a lot of different projects, you know, just picking up clients, kind of just trying to make things happen, make ends meet, find some revenue for the company I got to work with. You know, people who focused on copywriting and learned a lot there. I worked on launching my own supplement business on FBA in like 2013, 2014. And I actually exited that to my partner because I thought the market was too saturated. I also wasn't into health back then. I was early 20s and I was focused on other stuff at that time. So that was kind of my first experience with FBA, but it was a good one. And obviously looking back, the market was not saturated, so I wish I would have held on to that. But through that, I was able to work with a lot of companies on just getting more of wallet share or more conversions with the current traffic they had, and that's kind of where we specialized. And then towards the end of that, I just started getting sick of client work, honestly. I wanted to learn how to run a company. I didn't really know what I was doing, and I was looking for a change, and that's kind of how I got to EF.
Okay. So then what was the turning point where you're, you know, okay, I'm done with client work. I'm tired of running the hustle and bustle in my own projects. Where was that turning point that led you into Empire Flippers as, you know, director of sales?
So I actually, I don't know, maybe a year and a half or 18 months before I joined Empire Flippers, I put a refundable deposit on a business to actually look at acquiring it. That didn't end up working out, but I was always fascinated with the business model. I knew that, you know, I would have considered myself to be deep in kind of the web space, and I really didn't realize outside of, you know, Flippa, which seemed to be a much different model than Empire Flippers, that this was a possibility. So it was just really intriguing from there, and I started following them from that part. And then on top of the fact that Empire Flippers was a growing company, what I was realizing, like I mentioned a little bit earlier, is I really didn't know how to run a company, and I wanted to join a team that was growing and that was young so I could be able to kind of take in all of that knowledge and be a part of something that was already had a successful track record and was doing something that I thought was big.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, seeing getting my start as well from our podcast with Empire Flippers and getting into the industry through that. I completely agree with you wanting to gain that experience from a growing company. And, you know, since you've been with Empire Flippers for 4 years now, Alex, how have you seen this company or maybe even this industry grow and change over the years?
Yeah. So when I joined Empire Flippers, I was the first round of true sales hires. So you could probably say I was employee 5 or 6 of Empire Flippers, maybe depending how you look at the numbers, maybe a little earlier. And when I first joined, Empire Flippers was, I mean, I can remember flying out to Chiang Mai. I had like 10 days before when I made the decision to where I needed to be in Thailand. It was a much shorter window back then. And I remember telling my wife and kind of walking her through it. I didn't actually tell my wife until the second interview because I was like, there's no way I'm not going to get this. I don't want to like cause unnecessary fears. And then when I did get it scheduled, she was like, okay, I guess we'll figure out how to make this work. So I remember flying out to Chiang Mai, going into a co-working space, and you know, it was the entire team could fit at, you know, a dining room table back then. So it was a very different than the 60 plus people we have now. And just seeing how we grew and working with Joe on the sales side and kind of beginning the process, it was so early stages, right? Because we were so young, we had got some good momentum behind us, but we were still trying to figure out like what systems we needed in order to scale. So, you know, that's things that we've been working on over the past few years. But I remember when I first joined, you know, if we did a $100,000 deal, it was a big day. That was something everybody celebrated. Now we move a $100,000 deal and you know, it's great. We still want to be able to sell those businesses, but it's something we do almost on a daily basis now. So that's a radical shift to, you know, now where we're selling 10-figure or $10 million plus businesses. So I think that's the biggest change that we've seen in sales. And then just across the company as a whole, just being able to see us get systems and people in place and the right people in place to be able to take this to the next level has been tremendous.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you on that. And seeing the growth over the time that I've been following Empire Flippers from my start as well has been a really great motivation factor for me moving forward in my career as well, too. Now, on the subject of private equity, which is the main topic for this podcast episode, can you introduce our listeners who might not be as familiar with private equity? You know, what does it entail and maybe some of the details to give people a kind of up to speed update on what private equity is?
Yeah, sure. So, you know, private equity in general is a very loose term. It can be defined or applied to a lot of different investment vehicles or businesses. And, you know, typically what it means is it's just not publicly traded or a public access of capital. So it's people privately raising funds from investors and then doing something with those funds. And the way we see it typically deployed here is, you know, it's a group of people who have found the operators for these online businesses and that have raised funding at various different levels to be able to deploy that capital into specific monetizations or specific niches. And that's typically how we see it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, completely. So you're almost gaining a pool of investors that are high net worth individuals, and then you're gaining those investors in basically a pool to present these possible investments or these online businesses or assets as a whole to that group.
Yeah, exactly. And the structures vary widely, right? Like some of them are relying on family offices for their funding. Some are relying on high net worth individuals. Some have more traditional investment firms backing them. And along with that, the decision makers or the decision making structure is different at each company as well. Some are more beholden to the investors that are maybe a smaller company or a younger company. And then others really have, you know, full say over how they disperse that capital and how they invest the capital. So that's something that's interesting and is evolving rapidly as well.
Yeah, thank you for the picture of that. It really runs a gamut, like you said. It's from high net worth individuals to these kind of full-fledged investment groups that feel very similar to traditional PE, obviously in this totally new space for them. I know you said it's rapidly evolving. So I kind of want to go back to the beginning and figure out where things sort of started for us. I feel like that's always a nice comparison point. So can you just walk me through, you know, the first time that you saw a PE buyer come to our marketplace, just kind of walk me through that deal, maybe what your initial thoughts or reactions were to this PE-like buyer?
Yeah, so I would say our first kind of experience in this realm was with a longtime partner of Empire Flippers, who is Ace Chapman. He had basically a much more simplified version of this model for the most part. Most of his deals were, you know, a single investor. He would get a percentage of the deal. he would kind of be the expert on helping them acquire and be prepared to operate the business. But, you know, we're looking at $50,000 to $100,000 deals. Sometimes that number would go up, but it really just depended on who the specific investor was. And that's kind of the first, I would guess, introduction to it. As Ace grew, he started to pool funds and look to acquire larger businesses. I mean, he was actually, you know, buying businesses that were north of 500, approaching that seven-figure deal and ultimately surpassing that. But that was, I would say, the beginning of it. And it was a good introduction because it's a very simplified version of what we're starting to see today.
Yeah, you know, like you were saying earlier, the company used to be able to fit at just one table, and a $100,000 deal was a good day. Obviously, we're in a very different place now. I'm curious, when Ace kind of came to you guys, obviously as a friend, but he's bringing in big money and, you know, you kind of know we're getting into new territory. Did you kind of feel ready to take that on? Like, did that sort of show up in how you guys handled that first deal with him? Basically, like, how did that play out, this sort of new deal with this new PE sort of buyer?
Yeah. So, I mean, it was a little bit of a learning curve, right? But since we were primarily working with Ace, it wasn't too difficult. It was basically we had trust in Ace that the funds were going to be there when we needed them. And ultimately, they were, right? You know, part of the big concern with people who are backed by funding is whether or not they're actually going to be able to execute on the deal and who they're needing to get approval from in order to actually move forward. Because that's where a lot of deals die, when funding gets involved. So with Ace, the fact that he had the track record with us, that really made the process a lot easier. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think it's a really good note. You're saying there is a little bit of cautiousness. It's like, are they going to actually have the funding? Are they coming out and saying, oh yeah, we've got all this money, and then it's just kind of smoke at the end? When you close that deal, I'm assuming it was a success. I'm curious, like, did you think that this would be a one and done sort of deal? Or did you think that this is a sign of something growing? There's going to be more PE coming to us after this.
Yeah. So the cool thing was, is Ace was able to execute on multiple deals per quarter, which was great for a brokerage, right? It's great for sellers, and it's just a good opportunity in general. I'd say everyone on the team was excited about traditional money being able to get into this space. The ROIs and on these assets are just phenomenal, but until then, no one had really figured out kind of how to execute on it, even at the smaller level. And what was a bit concerning is there was a lot of people who were trying to figure it out. And depending on how they were raising capital or kind of their experience in the marketplace, they weren't actually able to execute on the deal. So we had gotten burned a lot of times, and we were losing our kind of trust that other people were pulling it off. So we kept raising our threshold kind of trust with new buyers on whether or not they'd actually be able to execute on a deal. And I'd say we didn't really see a shift in that until the end of 2018, beginning of 2019, where we really started seeing these funds who, you know, talked about how much money they raised, actually put it to play and start acquiring off the marketplace consistently.
Wow. I didn't realize that basically when this had first started, we were going through this process of getting burned. I know that getting funding, especially traditional funding, like you're saying, is always a little bit of a what if and a struggle. So yeah, wild to think that really didn't start solidifying till, you know, 2018-ish, like you're saying.
Right.
I think that kind of brings me to this question mark of today. So, you know, 2018 hits, and obviously now into 2020, we have seen things rapidly change on our end. Can you just paint me a picture of the current state of PE in our marketplace? What are those changes and what's it looking like now?
Yeah, sure. So like I mentioned, I think we got our first successful deal with a PE firm at the end of 2018, like the very end. Might have been the beginning of 2019, but I think it was the end of 2018. And, you know, they were able to close a seven-figure deal. The due diligence process, you know, was still being fleshed out by them. They were figuring out as they went as well, but it was a great first, you know, use case that this is working. And it was also an example of them having the ability to actually deploy that capital. I know I keep kind of reiterating how important that is, but so many times, like I mentioned, we'd have these conversations where they'd have to present everything to their investors, and there really wasn't a clear picture being painted that the investors could actually, you know, wrap their heads around so that they could actually release the funds. So us getting that done was a great first step. And then I would say probably within the next 3 months or so, we had another one come on board, and they were a very large buyer as well, an international client that had a similar type of model, but were more specifically focused around niches and acquiring within kind of niches that, when put together, kind of bolt on revenue and allow them to increase the value of these companies fairly quickly. And then I would say it probably took, 12 months, something like that, for us to start seeing more successful funds coming to the table. And this year, it seems like we're talking to a new one every week, and we're actually verifying their account that they have the funds, talking to them on a level that just really wasn't there, because that's something that's different as well. It takes a unique team to be able to make this work, because not only do you need, a guy who really understands the finance side of actually being able to work with the funders and being able to navigate that space and run a company like that, but you also need someone who really understands online businesses. So what was, interesting to see is a lot of the companies would have all of the finance guys, but they weren't able to actually digest and understand what they were looking at enough to make it work. And so now we're seeing these teams that are much more involved and much more operations heavy. And like I mentioned, it's crazy to see that $10 million plus deal that we're selling right now or sold is, we had multiple different funds trying to acquire it at list price, which is absolutely fantastic and something that's new for us as a sales team.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely incredible. Like you're saying, I guess just having done some research and written some stuff on PE, when I first got into it, I'm trying to establish what PE was. I think the status quo is, it's almost like a little sleepy. Like you're not equating PE with being like a startup culture and really going after things quickly, like moving fast and breaking things. I mean, this is, we are operating at a high level. We are operating with these kind of deals. And I imagine there has to been this sort of hesitancy looking at the online space to go, well, I mean, yeah, we've been operating here, like these businesses are working for us, but why would we get into these online assets? I mean, this is crazy. This is new.
Yeah.
I think one thing, I failed to ask you at the beginning of the interview was kind of what price range they're operating in, because I think that's going to be a little indicative of the sort of PE we're working with, right? Obviously, big PE, sure. The behemoth PE, probably in the, several $100 million range to $1 billion range, they're not going to come down. But who, like the PE that we're working with, like what's their sort of price range? And I guess what does that say about their ability to sort of pivot and go after opportunities?
That's a great question. So totally agree. At the high level of M&A, typically, those guys don't get out of bed for under $1 billion. And that kind of slides down, and it just depends on the model that company is looking to deploy, right? So they're going to put so much capital and resources into a business, it needs to really have a significant revenue amount for it to make sense for them. So that's one level of PE. And that's typically, like you mentioned, not the people that we're working with. There's kind of an emerging class of smaller PE that maybe they were focused on, a specific kind of vertical. And like you mentioned, they're pivoting a portion of their portfolio. Mm. But what's, I would say early on, most of the PE were focused, around low seven figures. And I would still say that for most of them, that's kind of where they have a threshold. But we're seeing, over the last 6 to 12 months, is that more people are figuring out how to make it work at the $250,000, $500,000 purchase price point. And the reason for that is it's just a model difference, right? You can acquire assets that are younger, that maybe have less of a track record. They might have less of a brand built, but the runway or ramp might still be there, but there might be a greater risk for that company. And they've just built that into their model. So maybe they're able to grow, 8 out of 10 at a much faster rate than if they were acquiring a seven figure or an eight figure deal. So we are seeing that number actually slide down, which is really interesting as well. And is something that I think is going to continue to shape the market as a whole.
Yeah, I appreciate that, because it's really kind of incredible. Like you said, it's like they're operating at this higher level, they're kind of coming down, and now they're getting into this significant white space in the high six-figure marks, below the $1 million mark. Mm-hmm. Like you said, more and more groups are coming in. They're realizing that's where no one's playing, but there's plenty of capital to be deployed and to go after opportunities. Real quick, can you tell me sort of roughly, you don't have to give super specifics, but the amount of deals we've sort of closed with quote unquote PE, maybe roughly how many buyers / groups we're getting at the moment?
Sure. This is a real kind of conservative or general estimate, I would say, but I'd say on a typical quarter, how we're defining PE for this call, maybe 15 to 20% of our deals are going to firms that have this type of a setup.
Wow. What a wild change. Did you think when you closed that deal with Ace that you'd be saying 15 to 20% down the road, all P?
We were hoping, but it seemed like it was years away. And I think that's something that you kind of alluded to earlier on, is how fast this market can change. Mm. It really, since it is such an emerging market, it's like technology in general. It just adapts and grows so much more quickly than it would if it was, you know, a traditional industry.
Yeah, and you bring up a solid point, Alex, as well, in this being such a new slash emerging industry. But, you know, as you had mentioned, we're starting to get 15, 20% private equity deals from our marketplace now. So I'm sure we've gathered some data, maybe some metrics from this. And now that we have an understanding of what these typical PE buyer personas might entail or look like, and the size or the price of these businesses, what I'm curious is what specific types of monetizations, or maybe even more specific types of niches, are PE looking for in acquiring?
Yeah, good question. So one of the things I think I always end up saying on pretty much every interview or podcast that I do is it just really depends, right? Because the model can work for anything as long as you've thought through how it plays out. What we're typically seeing investment in, a lot of investment into FBA businesses. I mean, the growth of Amazon, the market share that they have of purchases from just the internet as a whole makes that very attractive. It also, using Amazon, it kind of makes the entire ecosystem a little more friendly for PE, because it's a very strict system in a good way, right? So you can rely on Amazon to fulfill your products for the most part. You can optimize the supply chain very easily because it's still kind of a typical process, no matter the size of the business. You know, there's going to be some shifts, but it's going to typically stay the same. And you know, if you can do it well with one brand, obviously you can apply those same changes across multiple different brands on FBA. So we are seeing a lot of investment in that category. But we're seeing it in content sites, we're seeing it in e-commerce, and it really depends typically on the founding team's expertise and the model that they're relying on to build their business out. So I don't think there's a specific monetization method that works for this. I think it can be effective across the board. It just really depends on the expertise and what you're looking to accomplish. As far as niches go, that's especially just broad. Really, there's groups that are looking to acquire in every niche. And I would say, you know, even in niches that you wouldn't typically think are highly attractive, there's probably a fund either now that is looking to acquire in that vertical or is being built out right now as we speak to kind of focus on that vertical.
Yeah, that makes sense. And as you had mentioned, based on their expertise, they might have one monetization that they're more comfortable with and maybe less risk averse in taking something over at that higher price point as well. But I'm also curious, so why do you think that the private equity investors are now starting to shift into online businesses compared to your traditional private equity, maybe brick and mortar type establishments?
Yeah, and I think it's one word, and that's just multiple, right? So the multiples on online businesses are continuing to go upwards. But as of right now, 2020, we firmly believe that, especially as a comparison to traditional investments, they're undervalued and serve as a great opportunity. And, you know, kind of like with the oil boom, the first people that got into oil or the first people that got into railroads, you know, they were able to make mistakes when they were starting it because the margins were so good and because it was such a newly developed marketplace, right? So because of that, it just makes a ton of sense for them.
Yeah, I think on that note, like I like the way you compared it to it's like getting in early when, you know, the railroads are starting out, there's a sense of newness, there's a sense of like boundless opportunity. But I think there's opportunity on both sides, right? So what should sellers sort of be taking away from this conversation? What's kind of in it for sellers if they take notice of PE buyers?
Sure. I mean, ultimately, the market is what dictates, you know, what these assets are worth. And that's our ultimate function, is to serve as that marketplace, right? We would love it if every business would sell for 20 times annual. You know, our sellers would make a lot more money. But like you said, it's a double-sided marketplace and the buyers aren't willing to pay that at this time. And as we are seeing the numbers gradually slide up on these multiples, and I think that's going to continue. As a seller, I think you do need to realize that at the current time, you know, market value is dictating X for your specific business. And it really just depends on what your goals are as a seller, on whether or not it makes sense for you to sell now, maybe rebuild a business and kind of use that capital to grow another business, or deployed into something else that you're interested in, or if you want to hold it out and, you know, in 2 years time, you come back to the market and play ball at that time. There's always going to be shifts, just like with the stock market. There's going to be ups and downs, but I think, like we've seen with the stock market as well, that it's going to be a wavy growth path that continues to go upward. So I think you're in a good position as a seller. And, you know, for example, the whole COVID-19 thing that the entire world is dealing with right now is a great example of how things can change quickly. I think I was watching the Senate hearing or the congressional hearing with all of the big tech leaders. And one of the slides mentioned that we've seen a comparable growth rate in the last 3 months on online business transactions that we did in the previous 10 years. That's an absolutely incredible growth spurt that was primarily focused around something that no one really predicted, right? No one thought that everyone would be locked in their house or quarantined. And the transition from, you know, traditional purchases or retail purchases or whatever it may be to online purchases shifted so quickly. And I don't think we're going to see that shift back, right? Even as lockdowns lift, even as things change, I think there's an adoption that's going to continue. What percentage that is, you know, that's unclear. But that type of shift is just a perfect example of how the market can shift almost overnight.
I think that's an excellent point. It is sort of like this is too big to come back from. We knew the online business was growing, but certainly with this shift, it's going to be too ingrained almost in us now to sort of shift back. And I think from an owner's perspective, you see that and go, oh my gosh, if I'm not on this gravy train, I better get on. You know, I guess putting yourself in like a seller's shoes and you're trying to, I guess, put your business in a position that PE might want to take notice. Would you say there's like any sort of key optimization that a seller could maybe have in place to make their business stand out to potential investors, or yeah, just kind of anything that they can keep in mind in the process?
Yeah, that's a good question. And again, it really just depends, right? So I think the best advice for any seller is always to take your business to the limits of your skill and your passion for the business, right? So maximizing what you know best. And every seller is going to be different on what they're experts around, whether that's PPC, whether that's on-page optimization, whether that's supply chain management, whatever that is, you know, focus and double down on the low-hanging fruit that you know you can get value out of. And that's ultimately going to increase that revenue number, which is going to make more people interested in your business and is ultimately going to drive a higher sales price, no matter the multiple. Outside of that, you know, it really is going to be specifics, and that's something you should be talking with, you know, one of our seller advisors about as far as what exit planning looks like. But there isn't a magic formula for what these firms are looking to acquire in a business. And they're going to dig in and identify, you know, potential strengths, potential weaknesses for every business. And I think it's kind of like a dog chasing their tail when you try to create the perfect business for exit, because it really just doesn't exist. Your skills and limitations are always going to be there, and that's a good thing. What you view as a weakness is a potential opportunity for the right investor. So keep that in mind, I would say, is the biggest thing.
Yeah. And for this next question here, I guess kind of building off of what you're saying. So there's no perfect way to build your business, but I think if it's like, if you're looking to sort of capitalize on the growth of PE now, whether you're a seller, maybe you're a potential wannabe PE buyer, I guess, what do you think is going to be the outcome for these groups if they sort of catch on to the PE train earlier versus later?
Yeah, I mean, on the buy side, you're going to be able to acquire assets at what we're expecting to be a lower price point than they will be in 5 years. I think most of the market would be confident to back that statement. And as a seller, you may be thinking, well, maybe I should just wait 5 years and get the maximum amount of value. But there's always more value in a dollar today than tomorrow, right? So it really just depends on your goals. So is that 20% increase in sales price worth it for an additional 5 years? Or would you be able to deploy the capital that you get now more effectively over 5 years into an alternate business that you sell in 5 years' time? You're able to take chips off the table. It's just so highly dependent on each specific example. And that's one of the things that I love most about, you know, our job and what I get to do and help our team do is we're trying to create a win-win scenario. And that ultimately means is helping everyone get to their goal for the why behind why they're selling or why they're acquiring. And it's just going to depend. And that's something that you should talk with, you know, your broker or your business analyst or seller advisor about, and be very like transparent and clear about what you're looking to do, because it can really depend. Like, we're talking about very typical situations, but, you know, just like that 80-20 rule applies for most things, I would say 20% of the reasons of why sellers are selling are very, very different. You know, maybe they're looking to get cash because they are wanting to buy real estate, or they're wanting to get married, or they're wanting to travel the world for 5 years, or maybe they have a sick child that needs them to be home. It really just depends. There's no one reason for why a seller is selling or why a buyer is buying.
Yeah, very solid point, Alex, that you're bringing that up, and great insight as well into some of the psychology behind why you would optimize key features in your business to gear that towards private equity investors. Now, on the part of, you know, us mentioning, you know, our increase these last few quarters of private equity coming in and acquiring 15 to 20% of the deals on our marketplace, how has our Empire Flipper sales team been adjusting with this influx in private equity investors?
Yeah, I would say it's similar to working with a repeat buyer, just the speed has escalated, right? So typically the first deal with a buyer is always going to be the rockiest, because everyone's kind of figuring things out, especially if it's their first acquisition, like ever, it's going to be exceptionally rocky. So it's not even just the differences between our marketplace versus other marketplaces that everyone's having to get adjusted to. It's them figuring out, you know, what this process looks like for them. And, you know, from, I would say, our largest buyer, their process has taken, you know, 18 months to improve, but now, as a sales team, it's extremely easy to work deals with them because both of us understand exactly how the process is going to work, what the deals they're looking for. And these things change as well, right? So they made a massive pivot on what their acquisition targets were, you know, about 9 months into the process. They had acquired multiple different businesses. They reanalyzed their data internally and realized that, look, okay, X, Y, and Z used to be part of our acquisition strategy, and now we're actually removing that because this works better for our team and we're seeing results in these specific instances. So being flexible is something we've always had to do, but I would say it does become an easier process the more the buyer buys deals from you, right? You just get a better grasp of what everyone's looking for.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you on that. And it's a lot of insight, a lot of useful information, I'm sure, for our listeners that have been tuning into this podcast and, you know, hearing a little bit more in-depth conversation about what private equity is and what it is they can do to optimize their business to target these types of investors. But, you know, looking at the future and what our marketplace also holds for private equity, what would you say the future looks like for private equity investors on our marketplace? And how do you think the demand may increase or stay the same for these private investors through PE?
Yeah, great question. So I think the first thing is that none of us have a crystal ball on how the market is going to look in 10 years, right? And one thing to kind of point to that is when I first joined Empire Flippers, we did $8 million in total sales that year. Just I think last month or the month before, you know, we did north of $10 million in a single month. So we always set aggressive growth goals here at Empire Flippers, but trying to map that out on what that's going to look like in 5 to 10 years is almost impossible. What I will say is I think the growth is going to continue. And I think for private equity buyers, Empire Flippers represents a very unique opportunity in a couple different ways. One is we are the leader in deal flow for vetted online businesses. And that's something that our PE firms that we do work with very much like. It's something that has a lot of value, at least, you know, that's what we're hearing from them. And on top of that, the way we're structured, we're not individual brokers that, you know, go and find a deal and maybe we have a deal for you at this time, maybe we don't. We're not only just a team that has a group goal of helping us get to that win-win-win sale, but also we're heavily investing in our seller side so that we can get more and better deals onto the marketplace for the buyers to review and decide whether or not it's a good fit for their acquisition strategy. So I think that's going to only continue. And I think we've already seen a lot of success. And I think that's why we're seeing more of these guys come to our marketplace and talk with us about how much they like working with us, because we are able to adapt as a sales team and as a brokerage, not only to the intricacies that are around their specific process and acquisition strategy, but also because we have that deal flow. And as a buyer, that's such a crucial element to anything, to any successful businesses, is being able to have options so that you are able to pick the ones that are best fit for you.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. It's like, we're really sort of looking at the future with PE as a partner. Like, yes, we are a broker. We're here to help you with your deal flow. But I think done right, done the way that we've seen it and how it's unfolded for, you know, quite large firms coming to us is like, we're helping them scale to 100 million simply by coming through Empire Flippers. And that's not to say that we can't replicate that for other firms as well. The fact that we handle that deal flow, that we are doing the vetting, that the resources are actually spent where they need to be spent, and that's helping the seller and actually being there for the buyer. So yeah, I just think that's an amazing point, and to think about it as more than a broker. We could be the reason that you're going to scale where you want to in your portfolio.
Absolutely. Yeah, I agree that the partnership view is something that we hold true here at Empire Flippers, you know, across the board. And the investments we're making in technology, building out our own private custom platform, I think is only going to amplify the ability for these groups that are investing on their end as well to be able to have more deal flow, to be able to review more quickly, and to be able to ultimately close on more good deals. So, yep, completely agree.
Yeah, it sounds like a pretty good cycle unfolding at least. Well, Alex, I think we've kind of gone through most of our questions here. I mean, you've done an amazing job sort of walking us through the growth of PE on our marketplace and what the future might look like. Don't know if there's anything we might have missed in the process, anything else you'd want to weigh in on before we sign off?
No, I appreciate you guys having me on, and I'm excited to hear how this podcast continues.
Yeah, we will certainly be excited to be talking to more EF voices as well as some buyers and sellers as well. So stay tuned. Hey everyone, as promised, now that we've wrapped up the episode and learned about what the future holds for PE and online business, we wanted to connect you with some of our best listings for private equity that offer a great opportunity for those looking to acquire a seven-figure asset and grow their own empire. So first, we have listing 46644. This business is an Amazon FBA business in the health and fitness niche. It's a 3.5 million listing. And I mean, really, when I look at this business, all I can think of is it's just a well-oiled machine. It is primarily selling across the EU, solid operations there. But one of the best benefits about the business is it's also got an inactive Amazon US account in good standing should the buyer want to do that and expand to the US. So incredible growth potential right there on the cusp. It also has trademarks and brand registry. It's got 38 SKUs that are well diversified. And it's also got amazing social media. So currently they are pretty active with the social media accounts, using it to help launch new products. But they're also getting into YouTube with high quality product demonstration videos. So really it's just got a solid foundation for social media in a way that a lot of other Amazon FBA brands would struggle with. I think another great win for this is it's got a small percentage of earnings from BigCommerce and eBay, demonstrating that it's not just Amazon dependent and has the ability to grow on other e-commerce platforms. I think this would really be ideal for a large private equity firm who might want to take this over and they're looking to have a well-built out international online business. I think this would be the one.
Yeah, absolutely, Sarah. I couldn't have said it any better myself. I also know this listing once it came onto our marketplace as well, just not, you know, solely for the size of the listing, but, you know, also just how well of an oiled machine, as you'd mentioned earlier, it really is. You know, having solid SKUs and products in place and already having an understanding of what is working and what isn't, and you know, putting it all on what has been working has been, you know, one of the benefits the seller has noticed with growing this business. And it's really a great opportunity for someone to come in and, you know, might have a little bit of experience in growing this size of an asset or growing the size of an Amazon FBA or FBM business and really pushing it to its full potential, or maybe even a private equity firm coming in and, you know, scaling the operations using their dedicated team who are managing a lot of their assets and, you know, can really push this business to its full potential. And already having established multiple marketplaces and, you know, international presence is also a great opportunity for, you know, these types of firms. Another listing I had also noticed that was a great opportunity for high net worth individuals or maybe even some private equity firms would be listing number 47242, which is an affiliate and Amazon Associates business in the survival and security niche. This particular listing has affiliate offers that generate 80% of its revenue and Amazon Associates that covers the other 20% of its revenue income stream and sources. Included with this business is an email list with over 1,200 subscribers, and it's not currently being monetized. So this is a great opportunity for maybe a firm or, you know, some of these higher end business investors to come in. They might have a little bit of experience with email marketing or maybe how to monetize an email list that's already being established. And then also what's great about this business is it also includes over 18,000 OneSignal push notification subscribers. So this is great for those who are already shopping. They're already online or on your page. They get notified of a new product or some new content that might be coming out on your business. And now they're back into your marketing funnel, ultimately moving further along in your sales funnel as well too. So a great opportunity for someone to come in, scale this business to its full potential, having already, you know, some of the key features already established for you to come in and grow further. And that pretty much wraps it up again for this opportunity podcast episode. We really thank you for tuning in. If you did gain some valuable insight to the opportunities that digital acquisitions offer, go ahead and click the link in the description or visit empireflippers.com/marketplace to learn more about these businesses or other listings currently live on our platform. If you enjoyed this episode, be sure to leave a comment and subscribe to the channel for more great content that will be released soon. And until next time, we're your hosts. I'm Brandon.
And I'm Sarah. And thanks so much for tuning in to this recent episode of the Opportunity Podcast.